Our processional hymn this morning is hymn number 555, Lead On, O King Eternal. Would you stand, please? Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name through Christ our Lord. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ saith, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Glory be to God on high, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men. We praise thee, we bless thee, we worship thee, we glorify thee, we give thanks to thee for thy great glory. O Lord God, heavenly King, God the Father Almighty, O Lord, the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. Thou that takest away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. Thou that sittest at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us. For thou only art holy. Thou only art the Lord. Thou only, O Christ, with the Holy Ghost, art most high in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, whose will it is to restore all things in thy well-beloved Son, the King of kings and Lord of lords, mercifully grant that the peoples of the earth, divided and enslaved by sin, may be freed and brought together under his most gracious rule, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated.
Reading from the book of Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, behold, I myself will search for my sheep and will seek them out. As a shepherd seeks out his flock when some of his sheep have scattered abroad, so will I seek out my sheep, and I will rescue them from all places where they have been scattered on the day of clouds and thick darkness. And I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from countries and will bring them into their own land. And I will feed them on the mountains of Israel by the fountains and in all inhabited places of the country. I will feed them in good pastures. Upon the mountain heights of Israel shall be their pasture. There they shall lie down in good grazing land. And on fat pastures shall they feed on the mountains of Israel. I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep, and I will make them lie down, says the Lord God. I will seek the lost. I will bring back the strayed. I will bind up the crippled. I will strengthen the weak, and the fat and the strong I will watch over. I will feed them in justice. As for you, my flock, thus says the Lord God, behold, I judge between sheep and sheep, rams and he-goats. The word of the Lord. We'll read Psalm 95, verses 1 through 7, responsively by whole verse. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to him a song.
For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods.
In his hand are the caverns of the earth, and the heights of the hills are his also.
And his hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and bend the knee and kneel before the Lord our Maker.
He is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would hearken to his voice.
Second reading this morning is from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. In fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, but also in Christ shall all be made alive, but each in his own order. Christ, the first fruits, then at his coming those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom of God, the Father, after destroying every rule and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. For God has put all things in subjection under his feet. But when it says, all things are put in subjection under him, it is plain that he is accepted who put all things under him. When all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to him who put all things under him, that God may be everything to everyone. The word of the Lord.
Our gradual hymn is hymn number 632, O Christ, the Word Incarnate. Would you stand, please? The Lord be with you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. Jesus said, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. Before him will be gathered all the nations, and he will separate them from one another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats, and he will place the sheep at his right hand, but the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, 'Come, O blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from before the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when did we see thee hungry and feed thee, or thirsty and give thee drink? And when did we see thee a stranger and welcome thee, or naked and clothe thee? And when did we see thee sick or in prison and visit thee?' And the king will answer them, 'Truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me.' Then he will say to those at his left hand, 'Depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger and you did not welcome me. Naked and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me.' Then they also will answer, 'Lord, When did we see thee hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not minister to thee? Then he will answer them, truly I say to you, as you did it not to one of the least of these, you did it not to me. And they will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. The Gospel of the Lord. In the name of the one true and living God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Jesus said, when the Son of Man comes in glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. Before him will be gathered all the nations, and he will separate them from one another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. We have come to the climax of the 25th chapter of Matthew. Over the last several Sundays, we've looked at this. What shall I say it? Not ominous, but, prophetic, end of times kind of chapter in Matthew. Remember, 2 weeks ago we began with the picture of a wedding feast, a happy event. The man was having a feast for his son, and 10 virgins, 5 wise and 5 foolish, wait for the bridegroom to come. You remember the story. That Sunday's gospel was about readiness. Are we going to be wise like the wise virgins and have our oil restocked? Are we going to cultivate the love of God, the obedience to Christ, and carry along with us enough fuel to make it through to the end of time when Jesus comes again? Remember, the poor didn't think it was going to be that long, so they didn't carry any extra. Kind of like a Boy Scout that forgot about that be prepared part, right? Who took only enough groceries to get to the campground and not any extra in case the weather kept them from being able to pitch their tent, and no plans for having to stay a while before getting to actually get about the camping event. So that first Sunday was about readiness and about having the stock of love for God, because it's only the love of God that will fuel us through our life in Christ. Just self-will and strength of character is not enough. If it was, we wouldn't even need a Savior. But it takes love from God and of God to get us through to the promised second coming. In last week, we looked at that parable of the man who had servants. He gave each of them from his bounty some talents while he was going to be away for a long trip. You remember, and the 5 and the 2 and the 1, the 5 and the 2 went and put their good gifts from God to work and came back and returned, gave him his original amount, 5, with the return of 5 more. 2, here's your 2 and here's 2 more. Remember what the master said? Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful a little. I'll put much in your hands. Enter into the joy of your master. And so that lesson was about the importance of using and deploying our lives and what God gives us to the kingdom of God. And that being like that one who was afraid of being caught out and burying it in the ground won't do. Jesus said, hey, you should have at least put it in the First National Bank, and I would have gotten simple interest. All you gave me is the bag of money that I gave you, no more. And the judgment on that servant was severe. He was cast out. Especially in that second one, we're getting down to the ultimate judgment. Not just judgment as into whether you're going to get your paycheck or not, or whether you're going to be put in jail temporarily, but ultimate judgment. And this we're not real comfortable with, are we? Because after all, we're Americans. And Americans don't get permanent judgment, right? We are a people that believe that we can restart our lives anytime we want to. Right? And no one's going to judge me. Oh yes, there is one who not only can but will judge me. There is one who can and will judge every one of us. There's only one, and it's not a local politician, and it's not your mama, and it's not your daddy. It is this character that is becoming into focus throughout this chapter of 25. Who is the one who is the bridegroom? Who is the one who gave gifts to be responsible for? And who is it that is the Son of Man who comes and sits on the throne of judgment? You know who he is. The King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ. And he will return at the end of time, and one of the things he will do will be to judge. Now, this doesn't go along with the gospel according to sweet, tender Jesus. You know that gospel? That gospel which shows Jesus just cuddling the little lamb. Oh, I love you, little lamb. And every one of us is his little lamb. And he's going to pick every single person up and pet them on the head and say, oh, you wonderful little lamb. This is the gospel of permissiveness, right? There are no consequences to what you do, really, you know. Just tell the teacher your dog ate your homework. Or just tell the teacher that your self-esteem is damaged by having to be tested in the first place, and you're going to forego a test. Well, you can try that with your teacher, but don't try it with Jesus, because Jesus is not an indulgent parent. And he's not that concerned about your self-esteem, how you feel about yourself. Did you know that? I'm going to say that again. Jesus doesn't really concern himself too much with how strong your self-esteem is and whether you feel like he loves you. He's the Lord. He's the King. It's one of the reasons why in the church year we call this Sunday Christ the King Sunday instead of Christ the President Sunday or Christ the Prime Minister Sunday or Christ the local mayor Sunday. Jesus is King. And I hope I'm not the first one to tell you that, right? You know that. Just because we live in a representative democracy where we have the great honor and privilege of voting who are going to be our leaders does not mean that we get to vote on King Jesus. Hands up, everybody that thinks Jesus makes a super king and he ought to be king the next 4 years. Well, I got one vote. Okay. All I need is another 15 or 16, and we got him reelected. There's another one, huh? Two. Oh, three. All right. Yes. Poor old Jesus is going to get reelected. And I don't mean to be sarcastic, except I think we have to be corrected every now and then about our sensibility about the kingdom of God. If what we serve in, if what we long for is a kingdom, then he who comes for us is not the great psychotherapist in the sky coming to heal all of our bad self-esteem issues. He's coming as the Lord of the universe. If you read in Revelations, he can be pretty fierce in the New Testament, not just in the Old Testament. Strap your sword upon your thigh, O mighty warrior, the psalmist says, and one day Jesus is going to come and clean clocks of all his enemies. So with that as a backdrop, let's look at the parable today. First of all, notice that Jesus doesn't come to your house or my house for an individual judgment, right? That's what we'd like. We'd like on our judgment day to have our own day in court, right? Jesus, I'll meet you at City Hall, okay? But he's not coming to individuals here. Who does it say that he brings before him? The nations. The Son of Man sits on his throne and has brought before him all the nations. So this tells us that this is not just about a man judging another man. This is about the king judging the nations and how they have received or not received the Son of Man. So think United States, Russia, China, Afghanistan, Australia, Austria, not Sammy, Susie, Billy, and Bobby. Okay? So this end of time picture is first and foremost about how Jesus is going to judge those who have either received the good news brought to them in the mission field or not received it. How has Jesus been received in the nations? That's the first thing we want to take note of. That Jesus is, and then the next thing is to note that this is not an opportunity for all the nations to do their acts, you know, to be the, you know, the America's Got Talent in front of God. God doesn't say, "Show me what you got, USA," and we show him all the good things we've done. He said, "Hey, that's pretty good. You're a sheep. Okay, Australia, it's your turn. What's with the kangaroos? Ah, you're a goat. That's terrible." No. The judgment is not based on performance in the presence of the king. The judgment really is actually revealed rather than determined in that moment. What is revealed is what goes into being a sheep and what goes into being a goat. Now, how many of you have observed either sheep and or goats? Have you seen them in the pasture? Have you seen them in the zoo, in the petting zoo? Okay. Okay. Although we live in the country, we don't have a lot of country pastimes, actually. But what do we know about sheep? They're very herd-oriented, right? A sheep on his own is a sheep that it's about to get into trouble, right? That's why Jesus used that image of the lost sheep, right? And sheep tend to drift away. You know, they start looking for food, and they see something shiny, and they follow the something shiny and eat a little bit, and before you know it, they're a mile away from the rest of the sheep. So how does a sheep defend himself? Does he have sharp claws and vicious teeth? He got nothing. He's got zero. A sheep has nothing to defend himself with. His head's not even hard enough to butt and hurt people. He's absolutely vulnerable. The only thing that can protect a sheep is what? Well, a shepherd and the rest of the flock, right? You know, if I'm a little tiny sheep, when I get in the sheepfold, I'm going to find a big sheep and I'm going to get up next to him, right? It's going to keep me warm and going to keep me the wolf from looking at me, right? So that's why Christians need to stay together in a flock, in part. It's because we're much easier to pick off when we're off doing our own thing. You know, like, I don't need no stinking church. I can be a Christian all by myself. And your enemy is saying, "Yeah, you go, Stuart, go be a solo Christian. You can do it." Why would he say that to me? Because he wants to devour me. He wants me to get out on my own saying, "I don't need no stinking body of Christ. I'll just be Mr. Christian on my own." And that's a sheep that's just about to be devoured. So sheep need the flock, right? They need the shepherd, and they need the warmth and the protection of the sheepfold. Now, if you're of a certain age, the last thing you want to hear right now is the importance of hanging around everybody else, right? We grow up in our lives where we say, "Okay, I like three hots and a cot. And I especially like not having to go out to work. But you know what? I'm kind of sick of this us stuff. I'd rather do a little bit of me stuff." Can I get a witness? Right? Can you remember back to when you were 18 instead of 68? Or can you remember forward to when you're going to be 18? You know? We want to be on our own. And that's not a very sheepish thing to be, actually, is it? We need to be our own sheep, yes. We're not supposed to be one glob of sheepness, But we need one another and we need our good shepherd. Okay, that's the sheep. Now that's not a very flattering picture, is it? To be a sheep. Because they stink. And they're defenseless. And they're not going on TV anytime soon to be looked at as a star. They need other people. And we are a people that fundamentally are opposed to neediness, right? We'd rather be independent. No thank you. I know one of my arms hanging off and bleeding, but I'm John Wayne. I'll just tie it up with a bandana and throw some whiskey on it and go back out and fight again. That's our image of individualism. But we're sheep. If we belong to Jesus. Now, there's an alternative. Did you notice? If you're not a sheep, what are you? A goat. Have you ever watched goatses in the wild? Let me tell you about goats. They don't do no stinking herd the way sheep do. You know why? Because they don't want to be having to put up with you and me while they're off getting what they want to eat. They're stubborn critters, goats. And independent, too. They tell me that the stomach of a goat is so tough they can even eat 10 cans. I mean, goats know how to make it on their own. And they can make stone soup anytime they want to. They are hardy, get it for myself kind of people. I would say goats are much more like us than sheep. Or maybe it's the other way around, but you know what I'm saying. We are an independent people. We think it's weak to have to rely on other people. Unless we're the person everyone's relying on. And then we can say, look at me. Heap big chief. Take care of other people. Don't need to take care of myself. That's a goat instinct, not a sheep instinct. To be on your own, do your own thing. No sheep had to ever sing kumbaya in a circle. Never. Never. No goat. No goat had to ever get with his own goats and sing kumbaya and get in a circle. Goats don't do circles. You know what goats do? They'll butt you if you get in their way. They'll show you how dangerous it is to mess with a goat. So how many of you'd rather be a goat than a sheep? Well, I don't know, Father Smith. You haven't described the sheep as very good. And I don't even like the goats that much because they seem kind of rude. Well, okay. Jesus said he'll separate the nations, one group on his right hand side and one on the left side. Okay, and all these over here on his right side are going to be the sheep. All piled around each other. Stinking to high heaven, but together. Hey, if we're going to stink, let's stink together, okay? All right. And then over on his left-hand side are going to be all these goats. Not with just social distancing, but get out of my 10 feet. They're screwed out all over creation because goats don't do no holy huddle. Goats don't pile up on each other. And Jesus uses the most extraordinary measurement to say which is which. He says, you know, I came amongst you one time and I was starving to death. And he said to the sheep on his right hand, he said, and you gave me some of your food. You fed me. You invited me to your house for dinner. You took me to McDonald's and bought me a hamburger, or whatever, however you want to see it, you know. You saw my hunger, and you said, come over here. We got some food over here. He said, and I came to you after I'd had my Burger King special, and I was thirsty. And you said, here. You don't mind drinking after me, here's some of my lemonade. And I came to you and I had a bit of a cough, and you didn't say, have you been treated for COVID? Now, what you did was you said, can I help you with that cough? I've got some fisherman's friend in my pocket here. Here's a lozenge. Or, by the way, that cough sounds pretty bad. I've got a doctor. Let me show you the doctor that treated me so well. Put you in their sheep car and drive you to the sheep doctor. He said, and I once was a criminal. Had been judged guilty of a felony. And I was in jail. And I was about to lose my mind. And one day, the jailer said, hey, Smith, you got a visitor. Hey, Jesus, there's someone here to see you. And you sheep, you came and you sat with me in jail across the visitor's desk. I don't remember you saying anything particularly helpful, by the way, but you were there. And I thought I'd been forgotten. And the sheep said, what are you talking about? Jesus, we know who you are. We've never taken you to Burger King. I've never shared my lemonade with you. I've never even heard you cough, much less taken you to the doctor. And the last place in the world I'm going to find you, Jesus, is in jail. So what are you talking about? And Jesus brings out this motley crew of people. An emaciated old man. A man whose throat is so parched he can barely speak. A woman who's half naked, but she does have at least half of her clothes on. And a man with his chains rattling, but a look of content on his face. And he said, you did it to them. You did it to me. So Jesus, not Karl Marx, not the Republican or the Democratic Party, and not Stuart Smith, set the test for sheephood, responding to those who are the most miserable-looking people in the world. That's your test. And the sheep passed. But he brought the same group of miscreants in front of the goat. Only the punchline changed. I was so starving I could eat my boogers. And you looked at me and said, get the heck out of here. I'm going to feed you. I came to you and my throat was so parched I could barely even speak. And you said, this is my lemonade. Go to work, make your own money, buy your own lemonade. I came to you coughing, and it was a rattling cough, one of those productive coughs, you know? And you looked at me and said, get back. I don't want to catch what you've got. I sat in that jail for 6 years, and you never even sent me a card, much less visited me. And the sheep said, well, now, wait a minute, Jesus. You know me. If I were to see you hungry or thirsty or sick or naked or in prison, you know I'd be right there. I'd be your go-to guy. I never saw you needing that. And again, he'd run the same group of people by, and you say, you see these? That's me. This is the disguise I wore on Monday. Monday I came to you dressed as a hungry man. Tuesday I changed my outfit altogether. I was a thirsty woman. Clever, wasn't it? Wednesday I came to you and I was a hacking cough. I was a little infant in my mother's arms. And Thursday, When I was half naked, I came to you as a prostitute with a syringe in my arm. And Friday, I was a terrorist who tried to blow up a building in your hometown and in jail for it. And you said nothing. And you offered no help. You, sir, ma'am, are a goat. And I've got a place reserved for the devil and his angels. But I've just decided to make a little extra room in hell for you. So the goats discover the same thing as the sheep discover, that their whole way of life has been preparing them for what they thought was going to be good times. Goat heaven. What would goat heaven be? Well, everybody has their own little kingdom, and get the heck off of my property. That's goat heaven. Okay? Only that doesn't turn out to be heaven. Because they've been banished forever from the presence of the king. And the sheep, when sheep heaven turns out to be a place where all kinds of strange looking people have been accepted together by the king. And the only thing they have in common is the family trait of compassion, mercy, forgiveness, and loving kindness. That's all they got. They're still smelly sheep, helpless, hard to handle, apt to stray, but they belong to the king. And he takes them under his mantle, takes them into his kingdom. So in this parable, two groups of people have a place they're going, and there's going to be somebody in charge of where they're going that's going to give them what they deserve. Well, more than they deserve. Right? Okay. So the goats, they're going to get hell. That's what they deserve. And they'll have somebody there tending them. I don't think they ever wanted to meet him, but someday they will. And the sheep, well, they have a place they're going to. It's called heaven. And they have someone who will be with them forever, and that's the king. It's a wonderful hymn of the church that starts the first line, "The King of love my shepherd is, whose goodness never faileth. I nothing lack if I am his, and he is mine forever." So our king is Jesus, the good shepherd. And what will be revealed is that we've always belonged to him. That we joined his side a long time ago. And we began to act like him because we loved him and we looked up to him. And so when you have gone out of yourself and reached out and helped somebody, not for the attention that it gives you, but just because they have need and it touches your heart, you're acting like one of Jesus' sheep. He loves you. He's the one that put the spirit of compassion in you. The only reason you're not a goat is because he put his love on you and you said, "Okay, I accept that. I'm weak. I need a Savior. I need a good shepherd. I'm yours, Jesus." That's the life of a sheep. But on the other hand, I hesitate to say this, but since famous bishops down the ages have said it, I'm going to say it. One of them was Augustine of Hippo. Sometimes he says there's not only wheat, but there's weeds in the same church building. Sometimes there's not only sheep in a church fold, there also may be goats. And if you're one of those goats, then what I'm saying right now probably doesn't move you at all. You're just saying, "Ah, listen to that judgmental old so-and-so. He thinks he can tell me that I'm going to go to hell if I don't change my way of life. Who does he think he is? That's a very goat-like attitude, isn't it? I've had that attitude sometimes. When preachers start talking to me like they know me inside and out, they don't like what they see, I get right goat-like. I do. When my family, when my wife reflects back to me the way I've been behaving and I don't like what I see, I get downright goat-like. But if we have been mastered by the Master, if we've been conquered by the King of Love, we repent over and over again and say, Jesus, I didn't see you, but I'm looking for you now. I'm going to start looking for you everywhere I go, Jesus, because I want to be with you. I want to be one of your little lambs. I don't want to be a goat. I want to repent of my goat-like behavior. I want to follow you, Lord. I want to be with the nations that reached out to you when you were in need. So, Christians, we're at the very end of the old church year. That signboard says, last Sunday after Trinity. Kind of like the bus station. Last call. Bus for heaven. Checking out our gate number one. And we're over in the cafe saying, did somebody say something? Last call. So we don't really know, do we, how many more Christmases we're going to celebrate together, do we? We don't even know if we're going to get up tomorrow morning. Maybe that's one of the benefits of all this COVID fear that makes us realize how precious life is and it can be gone just like that. But next week begins Advent. And one of the themes of Advent is looking forward to the King coming back again. And this is where the good news breaks through all the doom and gloom. This is where I have to say to John Baptist inside of me, sit on the bench, John. It's time for the King. So beginning next Sunday, we're going to look at the themes of the coming of Jesus, the Son of God, and what it takes to respond to Him and follow Him, and how to be a sheep, not a goat. Lord, we ask you to forgive us for all the ways we give ourselves permission to resist you, to turn you away in the face of the poor and the hungry and the needy. We don't even see that their outward need reflects our own spiritual neediness. We don't want to see that, Lord, but we know that you have called us to repentance so that you can touch us with your forgiveness and set us free. King Jesus, this church is part of your kingdom. You are the Lord. We are your children. We are your sheep. And so direct us that we might bring many others to know the King and the security and safety of the King's sheepfold. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Let us stand and proclaim our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of His Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and descended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe one holy, catholic, and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's church and the world. Almighty and ever-living God, who in thy holy word has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with a spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. Lord, in thy mercy, give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, especially Gregory, our presiding bishop, Foley, our archbishop, for Ryan and Keith, our diocesan bishops, for Jack, our bishop emeritus, for David, Bill, and Stuart, our priests, and for Fanuel, the bishop of the Diocese of Northern Malawi, that they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. For Canon Ron, our consultant and coach, and for our shaping our future together process. And to all thy people, give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. Lord, in thy mercy,
hear our prayer.
We beseech thee also, so to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every land, especially Donald, our president, Greg, our governor, the Congress and the courts, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world. Lord, in thy mercy,
hear our prayer.
Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people to behold thy gracious hand in all thy works, that rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty. Lord, in thy mercy, and we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor Bob, Judy, Janelle, John, Caleb, Jim, for Bill, Becky, Phyllis, Michael, Oren, for Rule and Betty, Emma, Deborah, for Paula, Bing, RF, Tom, Zoe, for Hollis, Father David Cardona, for Dale, Ray, for Betty, Cora, Johnny, for Pat, Jean, Chuck, for Peggy, Debbie, Haven, Ray, John, Marty, and those whom we name now, and for those seeking the guidance and comfort of the Holy Spirit, the Cardona family, Layden, Kate, Lori, for Deborah, Faith, Hunter, Lauren, for all those who suffer from COVID-related illness, for Mackenzie, Bill, for Micah, Jim, Brian, Treg, for Michael, Kathy, Annette, Peyton, Robert, Tyler, for Nick and his family, Pat, Katie, the Goodale family, Lexus, for David, John, Ray and Marty, Sandy, Michael and Lauren, the Lambus family, for all missionaries, especially Rachel and Jamie, Dr. Glenn Petta and the SOMA organization, Kate Firebow, Reverend John Woodruff, for Colleen and Irwin, for Wright Whalen, Sister Martha, Don and Kathy Mingo, Andrew Powell and Union Gospel Mission, Tarrant County, and those whom we name now, for Shawee and Pearl, Father Andy, Lord, in thy mercy, and for those incarcerated in jails and prisons throughout the land, especially for Raul, Royce, and Cynthia, and for all our troops deployed in the Middle East and throughout the world, for Ernesto, Abigail, Josh, Scott, Russ, Lord, in thy mercy. And we pray for those who travel, that they may be brought home safe. We pray and give thanks for our vestry, for Vince, Yvonne, Bill, Mark, Marty, John, Susan, and for our treasurer, Jim. Lord, in thy mercy, we pray for the persecuted church throughout the world, especially for our Christian brothers and sisters in the Middle East. We pray for reconciliation and unity throughout the body of Christ. Lord, in thy mercy, we offer prayers on behalf of the outreach programs of this diocese and this community, especially for the Diocese of Northern Malawi and our sister parish, St. Michael's, Christ the Redeemer Parish Church, Cross of Christ Mission Station, for La Grande Familia Orphanage, the Brazos Pregnancy Center, for Camp Crucis, for People Helping People, our Anglican Church Women, Good Shepherd's Pantry, for Union Gospel Mission, for Order of the Daughters of the King, for our parish care ministry, sandwich ministry, Stephen ministry, and for our altar guild, Lord, in thy mercy. We give thanks for those celebrating their birthdays this week, for Gayla Harvey, John Sweat, and Nancy Use. And we give thanks for those celebrating their wedding anniversaries, especially Fred and Sue Rauschuber, Jerry and Kay Broom, and Scott and Amanda Hart. Lord, in thy mercy. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, especially Karen Harsley and for the Reverend Larry Dixon, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to grant us grace so to follow the good examples of the Blessed Virgin Mary, Blessed Saint Joseph, Saint John the Baptist, the apostles, prophets, martyrs, and all thy saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. Ye who do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbors and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and make your humble confession to Almighty God, devoutly kneeling. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word, and deed against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. The burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to the end that all that believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. This is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he is the perfect offering for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. Would you stand, please? The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us greet one another with the peace of Christ. Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty, for all that is in the heaven and the earth is thine. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord, and thou art exalted as head above all. Number 460, hymn 460.
Thank you.
holy sacrifice of this Mass is offered to the greater glory of God and thanksgiving for the gift of His Son, Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And on this Christ the King Sunday, thanksgiving for the kingdom that He has purchased for each one of us, and that we as a people may laud and honor our King Jesus. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is meet and right, so to be.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times, in all places, give thanks unto Thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God, because in Jesus Christ, our Lord, Thou hast received us as Thy sons and daughters, made us citizens of Thy kingdom, and given us the Holy Spirit to guide us into all truth. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify Thy glorious name evermore, praising Thee and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of Thy glory. Glory be to Thee, O Lord Most High. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. All glory be to Thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, for that Thou of Thy tender mercy didst give Thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by His one oblation of Himself once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute and in His holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that His precious death and sacrifice until His coming again. For in the night in which He was betrayed, He took bread, and when He had given thanks, He brake it and gave it to His disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is My body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of Me. Likewise, after supper, He took the cup, and when He had given thanks, He gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of this, for this is My blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this, as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of Me. Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of Thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we, Thy humble servants, do celebrate and make here before Thy divine majesty with these Thy holy gifts which we now offer unto Thee, the memorial Thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance His blessed passion and precious death, His mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto Thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech Thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of Thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with Thy word and Holy Spirit these Thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to Thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of His death and passion, may be partakers of His most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire Thy fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching Thee to grant that by the merits and death of Thy Son Jesus Christ and through faith in His blood, we and all Thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of His passion. And here we offer and present unto Thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto Thee, humbly beseeching Thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of Thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with Thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with Him, that He may dwell in us and we in Him. And although we are unworthy, through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
Lamb of God, that takest away the sins of the world,
have mercy upon us.
O Lamb of God, that takest away the sins of the world,
have mercy upon us.
O Lamb of God, that takest away the sins of the world,
grant us thy peace.
We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs unto thy table, but thou art the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank Thee for that Thou dost feed us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of Thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of Thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporate in the mystical body of Thy Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of Thy everlasting kingdom. And we humbly beseech Thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with Thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship and do all such good works as Thou hast prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with Thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. Please be seated. We have, of course, a very special week coming up because it has within it both the celebration of Thanksgiving Day and also at the end of it, the beginning of next week, the beginning of Advent. So it's a big pivot time for the life of the church, and I always get excited when it gets around Advent time. For Thanksgiving, we kind of have two options. Wednesday night, as you know, the Jewish day begins with the night before. So we are anticipating Thanksgiving Day Wednesday night with a Mass that uses the collects and lessons appointed for the Thanksgiving Day. We will have that here in this place at the usual time, 6:30 on Wednesday evening. And then afterwards, anybody wanting to go out on the town can, of course, do that. Then on Thanksgiving Day itself, the 26th, at 1 o'clock in the parish hall, we're going to have what's become our annual Thanksgiving feast. We've had some people sign up. There's still a lot of turkey and ham available, so if you have decided at the last minute that you do want to join us for Thanksgiving feast, come along, even if you haven't signed up on the list. But if you know that you're coming, that would be great to know how many folks are there. The church is providing the ham and the turkey, and then those who are attending are providing some of the side dishes and desserts, and quite apart from the gastronomic delight of coming together to eat together, it's just great to be together with part of the family of God on Thanksgiving Day. Some of us don't have, alas, relatives in town to celebrate with, or don't have a trip planned to go and celebrate with others, so if you find yourself in that position, and you'd rather not just watch the Macy Day Parade and watch the Cowboys get beat again, you're welcome to come here at 1 o'clock on Thursday and join us for that feast. Then, as I mentioned, Sunday brings Advent, and I'm going to stroll back here to get something I should have gotten earlier. We're going to spend a little bit of time in Christian formation today talking about what is this season of Advent. It's in our Sunday morning Bible study today, we actually talked a little bit of what is this season called Advent. It's not 4 shopping weeks until Christmas. And actually, there's a whole different emphasis than just gift giving and looking forward to here comes Santa Claus on the 25th. So there's booklets back here called The Word Was God. This comes from the John's Gospel, where it says the Word was with God and the Word was God. These are daily inspiration devotions for Advent, penned by Henry Nouwen. If you know who Henry Nouwen was, he's a contemporary mystic that wrote a lot of really good stuff, and it takes every single day of Advent, beginning with next Sunday, and gives you a focus in Scripture and in meditation for the year. So please help yourself to one of these, and you can incorporate it in whatever your daily devotions are, whether you're an early morning person or a bedtime person or in-between kind of person. This would be something great to have as a companion through the season of Advent. And then, of course, one of the things we always have during Advent or Lent is a quiet day, an Advent quiet day we will have on December the 12th, 12/12/20. And this year, I'm happy to say we've got Father Noe Sparks, a new priest to our diocesan area, who will be leading the quiet day. It's from 8 o'clock to noon here in this place. And we'll talk over the next couple of Sundays about what quiet day means, because it is an important opportunity for us to be still and know that He is God and to hear what God is saying to us. So that's coming up on the 12th of December. Then on the last Sunday of Advent, I believe this year that's the 20th, isn't it? The 20th of December, we'll have our greening of the church. And Mrs. Smith and some others are in charge of getting up Christmas wreaths. And you all can help if you'd like with the decorating of the church. We bring out the beautiful Christmas creche and put it in front of the altar. We are getting ready for the annual celebration of Jesus' birth, His holy nativity. And so that's a big day also, the last Sunday of Advent. Then, as usual, Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, we'll have three services at 5 o'clock in the evening, Christmas Eve, and at 10:30, the so-called Midnight Mass, and then on Christmas Day at 9 o'clock, we'll have the Christ Mass. You know, that's where that word Christmas comes from, Christ Mass, the Mass of Christ, the Mass of Jesus is coming into the world. That's what Christ Mass means. We'll have three opportunities for that. So I hope that you will take advantage of that. And then I want to give you a little hint about a special thing coming. Shh, don't tell anybody yet. But on the Sunday after Christmas, we're going to have a special guest celebrant. He's not a priest, he's a bishop. That's the only hint I'm going to give you. So that's something to look forward to on December 27th, right after Christmas. Are there any other announcements that need to be made? We will have Christian formation today. Today we're going to look after the refreshments. We'll be looking at the topic of Catholic and Apostolic, the marks of the church. We've looked at one holy and started looking at Catholic last Sunday. Today we'll finish up on Catholic and look at what it means that the church's mark as an apostolic church. What does it mean to be apostolic? And that will complete the series of the four marks of the church. And next Sunday we'll begin in on Advent themes. So I know you'll want to be looking forward to that. And remember, Sunday mornings, 8 o'clock, Bible study in the parish hall. If you remember to bring your Bible, that's great, but we happen to have a few extra copies of the Bible because we're a Bible-reading congregation here at Good Shepherd. So come and just bring yourself, and Bob Monson's doing a super job of leading this Bible study, and that's every Sunday morning at 8 o'clock in the parish hall, especially for you early risers. You people that say, well, 8 o'clock's late in the morning. You'll love this Bible study. Okay. Anyone celebrating a birthday or a wedding anniversary that would like to receive a blessing, please come forward. Would you hand me my prayer book? A couple of birthdays, it looks like, here, and then an anniversary over here. We'll start with Mr. Sweat. John, are you having a birthday? Again? Yeah. Let's pray for John. Oh, God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on your servant John as he begins another year, and grant that he may grow in wisdom and grace, and strengthen his trust in your goodness all the days of his life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep you, John. Amen. Happy birthday to you. Nancy's having a birthday. Let's pray for Nancy. Watch over thy child Nancy, O Lord, as her days increase. Bless and guide her wherever she may be. Strengthen her when she stands. Comfort her when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise her up if she fall. And in her heart may thy peace, which passeth understanding, abide all the days of her life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep you, Nancy. Amen, and happy birthday to you. Mm-hmm. And now, Jerry and Kay have a wedding anniversary, is that right?
Yes.
How many so far?
28.
28, that's a goodly number. let's pray for Jerry and Kay. O God, you have so consecrated the covenant of marriage that in it is represented the spiritual unity between Christ and His church. Send, therefore, your blessing upon these, your servants, Jerry and Kay, that they may so love, honor, and cherish each other in faithfulness and patience, in wisdom and true godliness, that their home may be a haven of blessing and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Okay, sir, if you'd take your bride by one of her hands, and we'll tie the knot for another year of blessing. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit bless, preserve, and keep you. The Lord mercifully with his favor look upon you and fill you with all spiritual benediction and grace, that you may faithfully live together in this life and in the age to come have life everlasting. Amen. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary. Would you stand, please? The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you always. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God. Our national hymn is hymn number 494. Hymn 494. Let us pray. Blessed, hallowed, worshipped, and adored be our Lord Jesus Christ, in his heavenly throne of glory, in the blessed sacrament of his altar, and in the hearts and minds of his faithful people. Amen. May the souls of the faithful departed through the mercies of God rest in peace, and may light perpetual shine upon them. Amen.